club meeting of art talkers, and I was giving a workshop on the topic of creative problem solving. So after all of us, 30 people in the room, sang some Britney Spears songs together, I asked the room, okay, so problems. But we're going to be solving problems today. Give me some problems. And the room fell silent. Okay, don't be shy. Really, give me some problems. And then, as if I heard something crack, I got a waterfall. And I got, yeah, Lucas, our members are not motivated to give evaluations. They just want to give speeches. Our members are not motivated to become club officers. They just want to enjoy the benefits of the club. And our members are not motivated enough to compete in the contests. They're just lazy and relaxed. And in that moment, I felt, wow, Toastmasters is the most demotivated group of people on the planet. But then when I compare that and right now, I am here in this room on a Saturday morning that's packed with people that you came to take a step to become a little bit better. And to take one simple example, the organizers of this conference. Let's take the example of Adrian, one of your area directors. I know that she was one of the main coordinators, maybe the main coordinator of the conference, and she had to take care of 101 things, and one of these things was arrange accommodation for me. And I know these things are not easy because I'm very demanding when it comes to accommodation. I have a very clear idea of what I need. I say, okay, I will be happy to come, but I need to have a place to stay from Friday early morning, because that's where my bus arrives, to Sunday morning. And I need to have a working Wi-Fi Friday 9 to Friday 5, because I have a normal working day. I will tell my boss I'm doing home office. My second home, Budapest. Adrian said, of course, Lucas, I can arrange it. I will make it happen. And I can imagine Adrian to write to 101 Toastmasters. So finally, on Thursday morning, she forwards me this email. Lucas, I got a host for you. And I read through this email, and this host says, we'll be happy to host Lucas. I say, oh, great. But our Friday is the day where we get our cleaning done in our place, and therefore from 9 to 12 there will be a student vacuum cleaning in the place. So I imagine myself on a conference call one after the other with a background of vacuum cleaning. I say, oh, what my boss says to that, but I can fix it somehow, and it's, tomorrow I will not be causing trouble. So I said, no problem, I can handle that. 5 minutes later, I get a response from Avi Lucas, the host. She just remembered that she had received a letter from the electricity company. There will be no electricity tomorrow from 9 to 3, but if you don't mind, they will still be happy to host you. I said, well, so one thing is a person vacuum cleaning with a vacuum cleaner that probably has to run on batteries because there is no electricity, or no Wi-Fi, no internet or everything. So I said, I cannot do that. And I expected Adri to send back to me, well, Lucas, I tried, find something yourself. But she did. She maybe spent part the rest of the day trying to figure out the things. And in the end, I got the best office I ever had in my life. It was just for one day, with a beautiful view of Danube River and the Budapest Parliament. And I think this is just the contrast, and I know that she had to do so many other things, but this proved the commitment, dedication, and extreme motivation. And I think, it got me thinking, okay, what is the essence of, or is there a way of bringing people from this side, they're not motivated enough to do an evaluation in a club, to the level of organizing a conference like this, with all that it takes. I was thinking, okay, so what, maybe we are leaders, so what can we do? What can we do to motivate people? And when I say motivate people, this image comes to my mind of a wizard that finds you and then he motivates you, and then you do everything I want you to do. And after a little bit more thinking, I realized, in fact, this is not how it works, is it? So we often read in books, or we often see in the movies, these leaders or motivators, the teachers who tell you exactly how things are. Okay, there are always 3 points in the speech, and that's what you need to do, and then you will succeed. Or you can see the dreamcasters,
take it, you can take it far.
When I was thinking, whatever motivated me, it was no case like this. What worked on me were models. Anybody in the room, have you ever wanted to be a model?
Girl, dude, I need to be shy. Me too, I've been Peter.
So the people who impacted me most were the people that did something that later on I wanted to emulate. The first name that came to my mind was Michal Juhas. He was a guy 3 years younger than me, 5 years ago when I met him, so he was 8 years younger than I am now. And he was the founder of the Prague Business Toastmasters. And at that time, there were 3 Toastmasters clubs in Prague, and the general notion of them was, okay, look, a friend of mine told me at that time, it's a little bit like Alcoholics Anonymous. People have hard stories from their lives, something very depressing, they write it down, they give a speech about it. They're more relaxed after they go home, they clap. And this Michal Juhas, he was in fact the president of one of these clubs. He was trying to change it, make it more business. He did not succeed. But he had this clear vision and he wanted to create such a club in Prague. And he did. And he came to every meeting. In every meeting, he would be the person to shake people's hands as they were coming in, to make tea for everyone. After the meeting, he would never have a seat in a pub, because he would be walking around the table to spend 2 or 3 minutes with everyone. And to the people who are not members yet, he would give them the application form and chat with them until they signed. It was very convincing, so it didn't last too long. And after a couple of months, he came to me and said, Lucas, I want to start doing something different in our club. How about you becoming the VP of membership? Could I refuse him? Well, clearly I could, but I didn't want to, and I said yes to him. The second person that comes to my mind is Peter Havel, and that links to the topic of people not being interested in evaluations or giving speeches. And let's be honest, how many of you have joined Toastmaster to be someone's grammarian? Someone's accountant? Someone's timer? Or even to give feedback, maybe to a stranger that you already know is completely hopeless anyway. No, not many of us. And I was exactly the same. I kind of am. But when I saw Peter for the first time in my life give an evaluation, let me introduce you to Peter. So Peter is a Czech guy with a perfect American accent. Later I found out it was Canadian, and that it's something different. With a powerful voice and unsettling blue eyes. When Peter spoke, he had the attention of the whole room, and when Peter spoke to me, giving me an evaluation, I felt like I'm going to stop drinking. So strong. And I remember one particular situation after me giving a speech about me not looking at the ground anymore. I have problems with keeping eye contact with an audience. He started the speech. Lucas, great, you didn't look at the ground for the first 10 seconds. He managed to put me down within the first 3 seconds of his speech, and then the rest 3 minutes he spent on building me up and describing what it is exactly that I wanted. And he was the model for me of a person who not just is as knowledgeable as I thought, Aristotle, he wrote rhetorics, like I felt Peter was his advisor 2,000 years ago. Not just that, he really cared about all the people that he gave feedback to. And I wanted to be like him. And I started reading presentation books and writing feedback to everyone who's speaking out. The third name that comes to my mind, I heard the name for the first time in the district conference in Budapest. Love and Learn. Anyone remembers that conference? I have a couple of people, I'm sure Hans remembers, I'm sure Mia remembers, a couple of others. It was my first district conference, and at the time I didn't quite know what to expect. It was interesting, good workshops, good speakers, but the breaking point came in the humorous speech finals. Speaker number 2 from Brussels originally from Germany, Carsten Wendt. He had a speech was called Latino Lover, Latin Lover. He opened the speech this way. He said, he raised his eyebrows. He said, stereotypes. Don't we all have them? For example, right now, you think German guy like me should not compete in numerous speech contests. Within 11 seconds, he made the audience fall in love with him. And with every sentence of his speech, he was able to strengthen that connection. In fact, close to the end of the speech, the audience was laughing so much, and he was enjoying so much, that it seemed that time doesn't matter for him anymore. And one of his closing words was, because he was speaking that in his next life he wanted to be a Latin lover, he said, in my next life, I will be an Italian. I will talk too much, and I will not be on time. And it really felt like he meant it. In the district finals, he went overtime. His speech was longer than 8 minutes. But it got the heart of every person in the room. In fact, yesterday I just wrote to him to check with him, Carsten, was it that you just wanted to finish the speech and you didn't care about timing because we were enjoying so much? And he responded, Lucas, I didn't know where the timer was sitting. You know, these three people were my, say, like Toastmaster childhood heroes. The first one made it so attractive for me to be a club officer because I wanted to be like him. I wanted to be the guy who makes a friend in 10 seconds and then signs an app for the membership. Peter gave this importance of the role of evaluator and the person who is developing others. And Carsten, he just showed me that it's way, way more important than just to focus on winning. What's way more important is to build a real connection, the real moment when you speak with an audience. And this is, I think, that sometimes we as leaders, either in district, in clubs, but also in our workplaces, we believe that to motivate people, we need to put some spell on them and really work or telling them, you need to do this, be better, you can do it. But I think sometimes what's most important is what we do ourselves, and whether the way we behave, the way we act, is something that others could find worth emulating. So right now I would like to ask you for one thing. Please take out your phones, it's permitted now. Take out your phone. I will give you 10 seconds to do just that. There are a couple of people who said that they wanted to become models. And let's make everyone a model right now. I want you to say to a camera and make it into selfie mode. I want you to give your best smile. I want to give your best look. I imagine this is a photo shoot for an agency in Tokyo. Give it a smile and take a selfie. 3, 2, 1, now. And you can go to the photo displaying mode. And one thing I would like to invite you to do today is to use this opportunity of this big area conference when all those master clubs of hunger are represented. Ask yourself this question. What is it that I can do today so that others would want to emulate me tomorrow? Have a great conference.